Joining the Illinois, oh, thank you, Max. I just wanted to say thank you so much for joining the Illinois Clean Jobs Coalition's Climate Pollution Reduction Grant Lunch and Learn. And we hope that today's session will help keep our community partners connected and informed. The Illinois Clean Jobs Coalition, or ICJC, is comprised of hundreds of environmental advocacy and justice organizations, businesses, community leaders, consumer advocates, faith-based, and student groups working together to improve public health and the environment, protect consumers, and also create equitable clean jobs across the state. And the ICJC, as some of you know, has been engaged in the CPRG process, including providing a list of project recommendations to Illinois EPA for the building, transportation, and power sectors, suggesting strategic considerations to address the staff capacity needed to respond to the competitive nature of the CPRG process, as well as conducting community engagement and information sharing with the public. So, my name is Angela Hsu, and I am the Municipal Engagement Manager with the Illinois Environmental Council. I'm so excited to welcome you all to today's Lunch and Learn about the CPRG in Illinois. Moderating the chat for us today, we have Max Touchette, the conservation intern with IEC. And before we get started, I just want to know a couple of housekeeping items before we begin. All attendees are going to be muted by default, and please do use the chat function to ask your questions, add comments, or provide resources that you think may be helpful. We also plan to have a Q&A at the end of the session where folks can come off of mute and ask these questions. So I'm going to go ahead and introduce our speakers today. We're very pleased to have here with us today J.C. Kibbe from the state of Illinois and also Nora Beck from the Chicago Metropolitan Agency for Planning. J.C. Kibbe analyzes, develops, and implements climate and energy policy as the climate advisor at the state of Illinois. In his last role as Senior Illinois Energy Advocate at the Natural Resources Defense Council, he was deeply involved in the development, passage, and implementation of the Climate and Equitable Jobs Act, or CEJA. He previously served as the Midwest Outreach and Policy Advocate in the Union of Concerned Scientists Climate Energy Program and as a public policy researcher at the Services Employees International Union, SEIU Local 1. JC holds a master's in public policy from Northwestern University, where he received a distinguished thesis award for his work on the politics of climate change. He has a bachelor's in political theory from Michigan State University's James Madison College, and he currently lives in Chicago with his wife and dog. So welcome, JC. I also want to introduce Nora Beck, who leads climate mitigation and air quality planning at CMAP, the regional planning organization for the seven counties of Northeastern Illinois. This includes the development of comprehensive climate action plans for the Chicago Metropolitan Statistical Area. Nora has also managed a variety of water management projects, including the development of a regional flood susceptibility index, the creation of a regional water demand forecast, and policy exploration on a variety of environmental issues, including groundwater governance. Nora holds a master's in urban and regional planning from the University of Michigan and a bachelor's in zoology on environmental studies from the University of Wisconsin. Welcome, Nora. So thank you both so much for being here. And with that, we will pass the mic over to JC. And JC, the floor is yours whenever you're ready.
Thanks so much, Angela. It's so embarrassing to have my whole bio read out by that. I did not realize you were doing that. Hi, everybody. Great to see what I'm sure would be some friendly faces if I could see you. I'm JC Kibbe. I'm the state climate advisor. I was also the lead on developing and drafting our climate pollution reduction grant application for the state of Illinois. I'll just give a quick bit of background on that was the timeline of that process was pretty challenging because of when it was due and when I came on. But we tried to do a lot of stakeholder outreach to build on previous stakeholder outreach. We had some good public conversations, including with some folks in the CJC. So thank you to everybody here who was a part of that, and I hope that you see some of your priorities reflected in the state's application. I don't want to belabor too much what the Climate Pollution Reduction Grant is, but I will just give a little bit of background for folks who may not be familiar. I don't have slides on this part, but there were really three parts to that process. The first was that the state got a planning grant for the CPRG a little over a year ago, which provided us with some resources to put together our application for analysis, consultants, things like that. There was also a priority climate action plan, which was really, you know, cataloging our state's emissions, understanding where the emissions reductions opportunities lie, and laying out some measures that we thought were promising. And that priority climate action plan defined what could be in our climate pollution reduction grant application. The application was submitted on April 1st. The total amount of nationwide funding that's available through the climate pollution reduction grant was $4.3 billion on the implementation side. Entities that could apply for that are states, municipalities, tribal nations and entities, and any sort of coalition that is a combination of those bodies. So the application that I'm talking about today was submitted by the state of Illinois EPA, and you'll hear from Nora, who worked on the municipal coalition application. So yeah, just to say, we're submitting, these applications could be up to $500 million. We submitted a $430 million application at the state. That is definitely on the higher end, we think, of what is going to be out there. There are some regional applications that also are on that level. So they're only issuing a maximum of 10 at that level across the country. But we wanted to aim high. And US EPA does have the ability, if they want to, you know, award a partial application. So we did not want to negotiate against ourselves. We saw a lot of promising opportunities for emission reduction, and that's reflected in the application. I will also say a couple notes about what is and isn't a good fit for the CPRG. We received very clear direction from US EPA about what type of measures, and we heard this in the funding opportunity, and we also heard this in a lot of conversations that we had with US EPA. They told us this over and over, that the measures that would be competitive in the CPRG would be ones that were not well served by other sources of funding, were innovative and or scalable, and offered benefits to low-income and disadvantaged communities. And so an important one to note is funding that is not being met by other sources. So we got contacts from a lot of entities who said, like, can you put in the CPRG to put solar panels on the roof of my like government building or school? And while we think that those are great projects and want them to happen, there's already a lot of funding that is available for that sort of thing. And so when we talk about what is in this application, I think it's really important to keep in mind of how central that criteria was, that we had to apply for things that were not well served elsewhere. So with that bit of background about the CPRG and what it is, some folks have probably seen the Priority Climate Action Plan that is posted on Illinois EPA's website. So that gives you some idea of what is in our CPRG application. But I actually have a little bit of a treat for you all today, which is that I'm going to share the actual amount that we requested and all the different measures. So you will see all the things that we ask for money for, and the amount and what those were, and we can talk about that a bit. So none of this is secret. We are in the process right now of getting all this up on our website, so everybody can have access to that information. But you all are going to be a little bit of guinea pigs to hear about this information early on, and your feedback and questions will help inform, you know, what we want to make sure to respond to on the website. So with that, I will share my screen here. Hopefully folks can see this okay. Whoops, wrong slideshow. Is this showing up? Looking nice for everybody? Okay,
Yes.
Great. So there were five sectors here, and I'm gonna go through those one by one. So Angela, I know you, some one of your questions ahead of time was like, did you apply for this or that? And we're already seeing some questions in the chat. So I'm gonna try and preempt those just by sharing what it is that we did apply for. So clean buildings was one of the largest two sectors in our application. I think this totaled about $115 million. The largest part of this was what we're, you know, what we call for short the gap closing fund of about $80 million. So we know and we heard from a lot of different stakeholders that there are clean buildings projects out there that are eligible for a lot of incentives that the people who own those buildings want to do, but there's like a little 2, 3, 4, 5% at the end where they can't quite make the project pencil, and really good building efficiency, electrification projects end up, you know, sitting undone because of that last little percent. And so this fund is intended to make the most of all these other building incentives that are out there to close that gap at the end and get those projects across the finish line. And we think the benefit of this is that it is going to mobilize a lot more funding than just the $80 million that you see here, the $81 million. So this is going to be mobilized. This is a multiplier where it's going to be leveraging other federal funds, state energy efficiency programs, private funding, and the idea is to catalyze all these other sources of funding. Second is consumer outreach and clean building project support. So this is, I know, an idea that the CJC had supported and some of its feedback to us, and something that we heard from other stakeholders as well. We have all these great incentives out there for clean buildings, but people don't necessarily know about them. People don't necessarily know if they're eligible for them, and people don't necessarily know how to wade through the application processes that are involved in getting these incentives. So the idea with this is do the education, do the outreach, help people walk through those processes so that folks, especially who may not be as familiar with this stuff, can get access to all these funding opportunities that are available to make their homes cleaner, healthier, and more efficient. Three is a clean buildings access portal. This is really just getting all the information online and in one place so somebody can go and see what all their incentives options are, get in touch with contractors that can do that work, et cetera, without going to 10 different websites. People are busy, they're raising kids, they're working multiple jobs. We want to make it as easy as possible for people to understand what these incentives are and how to get connected with them. That's the intent here. Clean buildings contractor training. We have heard from so many people that one of the biggest barriers to deploying these clean energy technologies is a lack of qualified workers and knowledge to implement them, even though we know there are some great workers and businesses that are already doing this out there, but we need to scale up that labor force and quickly. So this builds on, this would, if we get the money, build on some of the existing clean jobs training work that passed in CEJA and that DCO is working on, and expand some of that in the clean building space to get more folks certified in electrification, efficiency, and similar work. Large building owner and outreach. We think there's good incentives to retrofit some of these large buildings, but building owners, like families, have other things to do and other things to think about. So by proactively reaching out to some of these folks, letting them know the funding opportunities that are available, laying that out for them, we think that we can drive more big buildings than are doing so currently to decarbonize just by letting them know how good the opportunities are. Lastly, community geothermal, expanding that and doing more community level geothermal pilots. We think we could maybe get three or so with the amount of money that's here. Clean transportation. Probably many of the folks here, I don't need to tell you this. And by the way, Angela, if you want to like give me a 5-minute warning or something, if I start to come up on time, I do want to share this with folks, but I don't want to monopolize our time today. This is the largest piece of this. It's about $170 million, I think, in total. Or maybe this is the 115. Yeah, sorry, this is the 115. But we are the largest state for inland freight in the country. Those facilities are located near vulnerable communities that are exposed to a lot of criteria pollution as a result of this. Reminder that the CPRG is very focused on greenhouse gas reductions. So in our application, we really framed it in terms of the GHG reductions that we can get through this, but we know that there are also a lot of criteria pollutant and community benefits, and that was front of mind when we developed this part of the application. So there's good federal tax credits available on heavy duty and medium duty vehicles, but you need a certain amount of tax liability to apply for those. You need a certain amount of savvy with taxes and accounting to apply for those. And it turns out like a huge percentage of fleets actually have like six or less vehicles. So these aren't necessarily the, you know, Amazons or Walmarts of the world, but small operators who may not have the time or the resources to do this stuff. So we want to provide grants for charging infrastructure and vehicle rebates to some of those small and medium fleets. And we want to invest $44 million in that. Reducing diesel engine idling and electrifying like uses within freight facilities, drayage trucks, engines that are towing cars around within the rail yards and things like that. That's a major emissions reduction opportunity. There are federal funds for that as well, but we think that this complements, goes above and beyond that. This zero emission on-road and off-road vehicle deployments, this really builds on what I was saying earlier. This works in tandem with the charging infrastructure that I talked about earlier for those medium and small fleets. So the 44 million, that's for charging infrastructure. This 32 million, that's for the actual vehicles themselves. So that's both heavy duty and medium duty on-road vehicles, but also off-road vehicles, things like forklifts that are inside of warehouses. One of the things that we heard from stakeholders is that if you're working in a warehouse with a bunch of diesel powered off-road vehicles going all day, that can be a real issue for your health. And there are real greenhouse gas emission implications for those vehicles as well. So that is part of the package, the off-road vehicles. Clean fleet and freight concierge, similar to the clean buildings things, a lot of good opportunities out there to decarbonize transportation that people just aren't taking because they maybe don't know about them. This is the outreach to help realize more of those opportunities. Freight hub data collection and analysis, all this stuff we want to do to clean up our transportation sector and our freight sector, we won't know if it's working if we can't measure it. Some community organizations like Levejo have already done really good work with not a lot of resources in terms of collecting information about the pollution impacts to these freight facilities. We think that there's room to expand that, and it's both helpful for informing how we pursue these measures going forward, and also to just have more transparency for those communities about the pollution impacts that they're feeling today. Lastly, workforce training. Operating a fleet of electric vehicles requires very different operational procedures than operating diesel vehicles. We know that's one of the things that is holding freight operators back from doing electrification, is that they're not comfortable with running an electric fleet and how different that is. So some of this is for training workers directly. Some of this is for training the freight operators so that they know how to run an electric fleet. They feel more comfortable with uptaking those electric vehicles, and we can help address that objection. Okay, those were the longest. So on industrial decarbonization, again, the concierge, good federal tax credits available on the industrial side. A lot of industrial users just don't know about or think about them. We want to do some of that outreach and help get those opportunities in front of them. Fluorinated gas reduction program. This is a little bit of a not necessarily what we spend all day thinking about, but some folks may be aware that there is an incredibly potent class of greenhouse gases called fluorinated gases. Sometimes hear these called like HFCs that are like 1,000 or, you know, 5,000 times more powerful than CO2 and their warming impact. California has a great program on this. A lot of this happens in refrigeration. We actually do a lot of refrigeration here because we have so much freight and food storage facilities in Illinois and in the Chicagoland area. We want to start retrofitting some of those to use lower climate warming refrigerants. And we think that there's a really good bang for the buck in doing that. Then just noting at the bottom here that we're part of a regional partnership with several other states, Michigan, Minnesota, Wisconsin, and I want to say Indiana, that put in for a regional industrial decarbonization application. that would directly fund the decarbonization of industrial facilities across the region. We think that we can get a really good share of that here in Illinois, but we're winning. That's a separate CPRG grant that we went in on with partners. Agriculture. We do a lot of agriculture in the state of Illinois, and among states that do agriculture, I think that we are very fortunate to have very forward-looking elected officials and policy in that area, relatively speaking. So we saw this as a big opportunity and also an opportunity to make climate investments that will benefit central and southern Illinois. So more low-till, no-till, and cover crop. We think there's $74 million, give or take, $73 million worth of opportunity there at least. So this would be expanding some existing programs that the Department of Ag already has to do this stuff. Reducing biomethane. There's a lot of different places where you can capture biomethane and use it for things. Livestock, wastewater, landfill. I think it doesn't say this in the slide, but one important thing here is that we want to capture this methane and use it for something smart. There's a lot of ways that you can capture biomethane and use it where the greenhouse gas emission benefits are actually pretty minimal, like injecting it into the gas system. But if you use it for things that are difficult to decarbonize, like high heat industrial applications, that's a really good bang for the buck on methane utilization. So that's the idea with this program. Decarbonizing small engines. So we're thinking here about landscape equipment. This is complementary to a regional municipal effort that Nora may talk about. And there's sort of a gap between the really big landscaping equipment there's a federal tax credit for, but there's like a sort of a tier under that that's getting used really heavily by like landscaping companies, but that don't qualify for the federal tax credit. Those things spit out a lot of emissions and also a lot of criteria pollutants. So we think there's good value in decarbonizing those. Last one, clean power. This is the smallest of all the things we applied for. And I think that's a testament to some of the great work that we've already done in the state on CEJA and other bills. So the needs here aren't as great. This is really focused on supporting planning. So one of the things I have heard in the past from municipal and co-op utilities is that it is sometimes challenging for them to do all this clean energy stuff because they are just understaffed and under-resourced and they don't can't figure out how to do it. So we want to make sure that they have the resources that they need to understand how to do that clean energy transition and start to execute it. And so we're trying to get at that. We also want to expand some of the statewide analysis and planning that we're doing in clean energy. Folks are probably aware that there's a provision in CEJA that says if we are going to run into reliability problems, that it would allow pushing back of the emissions reductions targets that we've set in law. We would like to avoid weakening our emissions reductions targets. The Illinois Power Agency already is doing some of this work, but we think that there is significant benefit to providing them more resources to do it, to do even more granular analysis to identify those clean energy solutions so that we can preempt any potential reliability issues and make sure that our state decarbonization goals stay on track. So that's what we applied for, tried to get through a lot in a short time. Sure, we could talk more about this, but don't know if we want to go with questions. Looks like we got about 5 minutes for questions, unless you want to save that for the end. Angela, I defer to you.
Yeah, absolutely. So we do have a Q&A session at the end, but JC, we were wondering, could you explain what is the difference between like the planning stage and implementation stage of the CPRG, as well as how can groups engage or support the state of Illinois and the IEPA moving forward?
Sure. So the planning stage was really the process leading up to the Priority Climate Action Plan and the CPRG application. So the planning stage was maybe like, the months leading up to April, where we were doing some of that stakeholder engagement, where the ICJC shared that list of recommendations, you know, to us. So that was really us developing the proposal. And we received some funding for that, although it was a pretty limited amount. So now that we're in the implementation stage, our application is in. We expect a decision from US EPA on awards on the CPRG program in July. And if they stay on track, those awards would actually go out the door We think towards the end of the year. So in terms of what you can do to, you know, help, I know the CJC wrote a letter of support for our CPRG application, which was great and helpful. And I think now we're playing a little bit of a waiting game to see what US EPA thinks of the application. So once we find out if we've gotten it, if we did, I think there'll be a lot of conversations to be had around the details of implementation. We'll need to talk to a lot of different stakeholders about that. And I'm sure there will be many ICJC members that, you know, we'll want to participate, and we'll welcome that once we get to that point.
All right, fantastic. Thank you so much, JC. And we do have some really great questions, and we did reserve like 10, 15 minutes for Q&A at the end. But with that, I will go ahead and pass it over to Nora.
Hello, everybody. Let me figure out how to share my screen. I've got a set of slides here. Okay. Am I sharing?
Yes, it looks great.
Okay, cool. Hi. All right, well, good afternoon, and thank you for the opportunity to address you today. Again, I'm Nora Beck. I'm a principal policy analyst in our regional policy and implementation division here at CMAP. Again, CMAP is the regional planning organization for the seven counties of Northeastern Illinois, and we are charged with land use and transportation planning. So JC explained a lot of this at the top, but I thought I'd just do a quick refresher. Objectives of the CPRG program are to develop those ambitious plans to reduce greenhouse gas emissions and then fund those transformative projects to implement those plans. And both of those activities need to advance the goals of the Justice 40 initiative. So we are cooperating, as JC explained, at the state level and at the Chicago MSA level. As alluded to before, US EPA has a planning phase and an implementation phase, and the planning phase is underway. They've provided formula grants to almost all of the states. I mean, they provided them all to the states, and the states either accepted or denied it. And then the largest metro statistical areas were invited to complete and participate in the program. I believe it was offered to the largest 67 metropolitan statistical areas, but when a few states, as shown on this map, declined to participate in the planning phase, that allowed additional urban areas within those states to participate. So I think there's like a 74 metropolitan statistical areas that are developing comprehensive climate action plans. So for the Chicago MSA, the Metropolitan Mayor's Caucus responded for our region in partnership with CMAP and the Northwestern Indiana Regional Planning Commission. The Chicago MSA is 14 counties, so this is a slightly larger geography than what any of us are used to operating in. And there are three planning deliverables required in the program. JC really hit on that first one. It's the Priority Climate Action Plan. And for the Chicago MSA, the Metropolitan Mayor's Caucus develops that for our region. CMAP is going to be leading on the remaining two deliverables, and that's the development of a comprehensive climate action plan, and that's due in July of 2025, and then a status report, which is due in 2027, where we need to report out on our implementation progress. So I'm going to step through where we're at in these first two deliverables. So again, the Priority Climate Action Plan provides that list of near-term, high-priority, implementation-ready measures to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. And as JC explained, you know, this plan is trying to guide the competitive implementation funding that is the second portion of this federal program. So for the Chicago MSA, our PCAP was finalized at the beginning of March by the Metropolitan Mayor's Caucus, and they've been able to meet this tight deadline due to all the prior work that they've done in the space on regional climate action planning. CMAP assisted on this work in a couple of key areas. We helped develop the greenhouse gas inventory for this geography. We made our own recommendations of strategies that could be included in the plan. And then we helped with a couple of other critical elements, including the identification of low-income and disadvantaged communities as defined by US EPA. And I'll share our work on that in a little bit. For the CPR implementation phase, you know, as JC explained, this is the second portion of the funding. It's sort of happening at the same time as all the planning work, and it's a really tight turnaround. But they offered competitive implementation grants for strategies and jurisdictions that are covered by these priority climate action plans. So at CMAP, we worked with leaders across the region and with JC to make sure that we were participating in this implementation opportunity and put forth competitive applications. And we focused in on working with county partners, given the requirement that it be a government entity and just the size and scale of the potential awards. It sort of warranted that this larger collaboration. CMAP itself did not submit an application. And as JC stated earlier, this is a really competitive process. So we're really hoping that, you know, we'll be lucky if we get one for the Chicago MSA. And so it's really important to coordinate with our partners and make sure we were putting forth competitive applications. So my understanding of what regional partners submitted is included in this list. And we're really submitting at a variety of different funding levels, addressing different sources of emissions, and tackling sectors that lack other funding opportunities. That's a really key point of the CPRG program. So the city of Chicago connected with Cook County as well as DuPage, and they've partnered on an application that focuses on industrial and public sector building decarbonization, as well as waste reduction and composting. You'll also see that we have a coalition of wastewater districts that are focused on stopping the flaring of biogas from their treatment processes. And so that was an exciting project that also rose to the top. Kane and DuPage counties submitted for a variety of different projects. They really used sort of a different process than what Cook did. They directly contacted municipal governments and had a good understanding of what different communities wanted to see happen. And so their application is built that way. And then Metropolitan Mayor's Caucus also submitted for a landscape equipment buyback program. And I forgot, Regional Transit already submitted for bus electrification, as well as some service improvements for Metra to correspond with some new train sets that they're receiving through the congestion mitigation and air quality program that CMAP administers. So this is what we know about. If any of you know of additional applications that came in, we'd love to know about it. But I want to spend the rest of the time talking about the next item on our horizon, which is the development of a comprehensive climate action plan. So again, this is required through US EPA, and CMAP will be leading this work for our region in partnership with the Metropolitan Mayor's Caucus and the Northwest Indiana Regional Planning Commission. This plan needs to identify solutions to address all the significant sources and sinks of greenhouse gas emissions. And we need to be able to estimate GHG reductions from those strategies, develop implementation targets that demonstrate how the region will meet those national goals of net zero by 2050. And we have just over a year before this plan is due to US EPA in July of 2025. So the CCAP is really focused on laying out this larger, longer term strategy for meeting national emission goals. And so it's not directly connected to a funding source like the PCAP was, but I'm hopeful that these plans could be used to determine funding opportunities in the future, given how many states and metropolitan areas are responding to this US EPA program. I also wanted to just reflect on all the sectors that this plan will need to address to be comprehensive and meet the goals of the US EPA program. So we're literally gonna have to talk about everything in this planning process, and we're gonna have to work with an array of partners that across a much larger geography than what CMAP is used to. So the solutions are gonna be hard, right? They're gonna have potential to impact every resident, business, and jurisdiction. And so we're really hoping to work together with all of the stakeholders to identify and support strategies that are best suited to reaching these goals. And we recognize that many of these strategies are gonna reduce emissions have great co-benefits, like cleaning our air of criteria pollutants, making our streets safer, building communities that are healthier and more active, providing better access to job centers, cutting energy and transportation costs. We could keep going down that list. And a lot of these goals have been at the core of our regional vision at CMAP. And now the climate crisis is giving us added weight and urgency to implement them. So as we gear up for the Comprehensive Climate Action Plan, I did want to share a bit about what we learned from the development of the greenhouse gas inventory for the 14 counties of the Chicago MSA. You may know that CMAP has regularly produced a greenhouse gas emission inventory over the past 15 years to help inform decision-making within the 7 counties. And this inventory that we did for this planning process had to use a slightly different methodology given the different geography and that it's relying on more national data and tools. This also meant that we had to pick 2020 as the base year due to the availability of federal data sets. And I just want to let you know that that gave us pause too, because we know that 2020 was a pretty atypical year. But after further digging, we concluded it was still viable for this analysis. The inventory is built using both modeled and reported data from various timescales. And so we suspect that could reduce the impact of those fluctuations that we saw in 2020. In addition, when we can compare the 2020 inventory to past efforts to study emissions subregionally within the boundary, we see comparable results. So this pie chart is showing you the emissions by sector for the 14 counties in the Chicago MSA, and it's approximately 160 million metric tons in 2020 of carbon dioxide equivalent. The inventory confirms two prominent emission sectors, industry in light blue and transportation in dark blue, which comprise over 50% of total emissions. We know that our region plays an important role as a national transportation and manufacturing hub, and these economic drivers produce significant greenhouse gas emissions and make the region a major contributor to the national total GHG output. We're also able to explore the data by county, and this really shows the wide variation we see in the emissions profile and in the per capita rates. And this variation probably, if you're familiar with the Chicago region, this variation probably makes a lot of sense to you. It reflects the variation we see in the built environment, in the industry clusters, in the transportation system across the larger MSA. And it makes me think of just how varied our solutions are going to need to be to tackle the emissions in these different areas. Our Comprehensive Climate Action Plan is definitely going to need to identify regional and state scale strategies, but we also recognize that we're going to need to craft the strategies to meet the different locations and make sure that we're identifying effective strategies for those. Another deliverable that we produce for the Priority Climate Action Plan is the identification of what US EPA identified as low-income and disadvantaged communities. They required the use of CGEST, the Climate Economic Justice Screening Tool, and EJ Screen Supplemental Indices to identify this population. And it was needed for the PCAP to inform the implementation grant application that I talked about earlier. But for the Comprehensive Climate Action Plan, the US EPA is requiring that we go a step further, that there's a stakeholder engagement process of this population to identify the co-benefits that the plan needs to respond to, and that we need to do a qualitative and quantitative benefits analysis of how those GHG reductions are addressing conditions in this geography. So we are now engaged in an effort to explore the data in more detail to make sure we understand how are different areas getting flagged. Are they getting flagged for multiple environmental risks? We're also comparing this information to the tools that have already been developed in our region or in the state. So the Illinois Equity Investment Eligible Community Map, Chicago's Cumulative Impact Assessment, as well as USDOT's Equitable Transportation Community Explorer. So this will be a big component of the work going forward over the next year, 14 months. And then just a reminder that this map is identifying about 40% of the population within the MSA. I'm not going to read all of these things, but I did want to highlight that our timeline is tight for such a large geography and a complicated topic, and it's got to be tight, right? We have no time to lose on this effort. We have begun our decarbonization research on each sector. We're going to begin stakeholder engagement soon. And come fall, we need to start identifying those reduction strategies and begin estimating their effectiveness at reducing emissions in order to build that like plan implementation scenario from which we will then be required to set reduction targets overall. And we're aiming to set sector targets as well. So that was probably a lot. Thanks for your time. I hope I've provided you with a solid understanding of how we're approaching a comprehensive climate action plan going forward, and happy to talk about any of these components with you. So thanks.
Thank you so much, Nora. That was really great. All right, and now we'll pass it over to Max. We saw some really, really great questions in the chat already. And if you're on Zoom on the line, feel free to also use the raise hand function, and we can also call on you to ask your questions that way.
Yes, so we had two questions at the very beginning, which may have been answered already, but from Ellen Partridge, how is transportation beyond EVs included in the grant?
Great, and I do know that I did see in JC Kibbe's presentation the slide about transportation. JC, I can pass it to you. We're also sharing these slides after the session as well.
Hey, can folks hear me?
Yes, we can.
Great. Good question, Alan. I think the short answer is that it's not, but not because mobility is not tremendously important to me and to the state, but rather because after a fair amount of discussion with various stakeholders about this, there are two things you can do. You can send more money to planning for mobility. And what we heard is that a lack of funds for planning is actually not the problem as to why we don't have better mobility options than we do. The second part of it is that you could send that money to capital or to operations, but the problems there are multiple, which is that the entirety of the CPRG money, if we were to put it into transportation capital funding, while it seems big for the things that we're using it for, it would be a drop in the bucket in the world of transportation capital. And that would require, you know, shortchanging everything else that we wanted to pursue. And also that was not an area, it's like, we have money for transportation capital. Some people might say that we could allocate that in a way that was better for the climate, but the money is there. And on the operations side, a limited 5-year grant is really just not a great way to fund transportation operations. And I think that there's likely to be other conversations about that at the state level in the next year. So I think we tried to look high and low for ways to incorporate mobility into this, and it ultimately was just not a good fit for the way that this funding was structured.
Great, thank you. Another question from the very beginning from Bob Babcock. Is this strictly for governmental entities?
I'm not sure I totally understand the question. The grants that we're talking about, you did have to be a governmental entity or a tribal one to apply. If we are funded to do this, when those funds are allocated, some of them will go to private entities.
Awesome, thank you. From Anna Chott, would IEPA be the one to develop the programs listed in JC's presentation, for example, contractor training, and will re-grant programs be created for equipment like electrified fleets?
So on the job training programs, we aren't not trying to reinvent the wheel there. DCEO is already in depending on the program, in various stages of implementing those. And the idea is to piggyback on that programmatic structure rather than creating brand new programs. So IEPA would not be running those. DCEO would. And then, I'm sorry, I think there was another question about that too, or another question there. What was it?
Yes. Will re-grant programs be created for equipment like electrified fleets?
Yes.
Awesome. Okay. The next two questions are for Nora. So going back to the CPAP using CEJST and EJ screen supplemental indexes, this question is from Deborah Singleton. What qualifies as co-benefits?
Yeah, great question. So the US EPA guidance requires that the Comprehensive Climate Action Plan do, I guess I can group it into two different things. When we develop our plan implementation scenario, which includes, you know, building our reduction strategies, quantifying the potential of GHG reductions, then we need to analyze the benefits of those strategies. And there's a requirement that we analyze the criteria pollutant reduction. So that's like a very focused EPA, you know, wanting to look, see at how could that help us with other air quality goals of PM 2.5 reduction, ozone, et cetera, et cetera. And then we also need to analyze it for the co-benefits that are determined through a stakeholder engagement process with low-income and disadvantaged communities. So those co-benefits have not yet been defined because we're just launching that stakeholder engagement process. But they could be things like job access or, I don't know what they could be. They could be cover a broad range of things. And so we're really hoping to use stakeholder feedback to define that. And we recognize that that's probably going to be analyzed from, you know, some of them can only be analyzed qualitatively, and then other ones where maybe we could get to a quantitative analysis for them. So, to be determined.
Thank you, Nora. This next one is from Jan Budart. It's a mix of questions and comments. Could we look again at the total emissions per county with a blue dot for the per capita emissions? It's very interesting, and it might elicit questions if we could examine the data a little longer. And I am personally interested in you and your education. How did you get here? That delivery was very impressive.
Oh, that's really sweet. Thank you. I have a master's in urban planning and a degree in zoology from the University of Wisconsin. And I've been working at CMAP for about 12 years, mostly in the water supply and stormwater sphere. So the agency is getting really focused on climate mitigation and especially with the support of the US EPA money. And so looking forward to getting into this topic. And Jan, here is that slide. Am I sharing it correctly? Probably not. Am I showing it, Angela? I'm not
seeing anything.
Not yet.
Oh, okay. I did not do that right. Sorry. Now maybe it's showing up.
Looks good.
Okay. Yeah. So this is the GHG emissions by county for the 14 counties in the Chicago MSA. And so you'll see the first nine are in Illinois. So from Cook to Grundy. And then the next four are in Indiana, Newton, Jasper, Porter, and Lake, and then Kenosha County in Wisconsin. And so we have the total emissions, and that bar chart, that axis is on the left, and then the per capita emissions, that axis is shown on the right. So you see some pretty big variation within the Illinois section. Our per capita rates are pretty comparable, right? In Indiana, I think we can explain some of these higher per capita rates. In Newton, I think it's Newton, there is a large landfill and very low population count, so that's probably contributing to the high rates. Similarly, we see a lot of industry and industrial process emissions in Porter and Lake County in Indiana. So that might also be contributing to the high per capita rates. We're still busy analyzing these emissions. If you have additional questions that you'd like us to ask of the data, I'm very open to it. And we are learning, you know, just how different this region is within itself. It's pretty illuminating.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Another question from Caroline Wooten. I think this one is for JC. What about things beyond public transit? Example, bike and pedestrian infrastructure. What is the barrier there, and is it a lack of measurability?
Yes, good question. I don't know that it's a lack of measurability. I think the dynamics for non-public transit mobility infrastructure are kind of the same as for public transit mobility infrastructure, which is that, except without the operations part. So if you want more mobility infrastructure for like walking and biking, you can, and your only tool is to fund it. You have two options. You can fund planning. And again, when we talked to like municipalities and IDOT about this, the consensus was the problem, to the extent that we're not getting as much mobility infrastructure as we would like, the problem does not seem to be a lack of funds for planning. In fact, it seems like there's a fair number of projects that get planned, quote unquote, but then don't actually make their way into capital plans, was like identified as maybe the main obstacle there. And that's not something that we can solve at the state level just with funding, is my understanding. The other part of it is the capital dollars. But again, this amount of money is not huge in the world of capital. And again, that was like I think to the extent that you're worried about us not investing enough in mobility infrastructure for walking and biking, probably the solutions there lie more in changing the way that we do our planning than like a lack of money to do this.
I'd like to just talk about another project that we have in the hopper in the Chicago region. So earlier this fiscal year, CMAP was awarded an award from the Department of Energy to work with Argonne National Laboratory, ComEd, Oak Ridge National Laboratory, and the Respiratory Health Association on a scenario planning exercise with the power of the national laboratories to understand how we can get transportation emissions to zero by 2050. That project is going to follow a slightly different timescale than what we have to do for the Comprehensive Climate Action Plan, but we are going to be asking these questions and going through a much more intensive modeling process to understand how to get transportation emissions to zero. And part of that will be about electrification, right? And that's why we brought ComEd on board to try to figure out how, as transportation planners and utility planners, how are we gonna work towards this common goal of net zero? But also it'll be about all the other strategies that we need to throw at the wall to get to zero emissions. And so we're hoping that we can use better understand the role of bike ped and how that can contribute to the solution through that exercise.
Thank you so much. From Zimria Todd, does CPRG have discretionary funding for targeted urban disadvantaged communities and electrical vehicle charging stations?
I'm sorry, I was trying to read something in the chat and I missed that.
You're totally fine. Does CPRG have discretionary funding for targeted urban disadvantaged communities and electrical vehicle charging stations?
So I don't know what we mean by discretionary, but there is an amount of, if we are awarded the money we ask for, there will be a certain amount of funds that are allocated towards charging. That will be for heavy duty vehicle charging, not for light duty vehicle charging. There's already, again, remember the guiding principle here is things that are not well resourced elsewhere. There is a lot of money already out there for light duty vehicle charging. And that is actually being deployed pretty quickly. But the heavy duty is what we have repeatedly heard as a strong need for electrification of freight from EJ communities, and there's not a lot going to that. So that is why there's the focus on heavy duty charging. In terms of whether it is targeted for disadvantaged communities, the plan, if we get this money, is that Illinois EPA would re-grant this to the entities who would be deploying the charging infrastructure. And we don't yet have the money, so we don't yet have the rubric that we would use to assess those grants. But I feel quite confident that bringing benefits to environmental justice communities will be a very high priority if and when we consider those grants.
Awesome. Thank you. And this is the last question from Scott. I still am unclear on the funding that JC spoke about. If their request is awarded to them, is that money already spoken for? Or will stakeholders have the opportunity to submit proposals to obtain funding for projects?
So Illinois EPA would re-grant this and people would be able to submit proposals. So there are not, like, we don't already have a secret list of projects somewhere that all this money is going to. That is not decided. That would, if we get the money, that'll be decided as part of part of a re-granting process.
All right, with that, thank you everyone so much for attending the Illinois Clean Jobs Coalition's CPRG Lunch and Learn. Thank you very much to both Norbeck and JC Kibbe for dedicating their valuable time to sharing this information with us. It's incredibly exciting to learn about what's available, and we'll wait to see what happens with the funding in the future. Yes, thank you so much. If you like today's session, just quick little plug. This was an ICJC Lunch and Learn, but if you are interested and want to learn more about different issue areas from IEC, I just pasted the wrong link in the chat, but this is the correct link in the chat to our Lunch and Learn series. So feel free to join us there, and thank you and have a great day.